So let me proceed with our today's class with revision, and revision is of short-term decision making. I told you that we are going through this chapter. What is this chapter? This is short-term decision making, and long-term decision making is supposed to be done with, is supposed to be done in capital budgeting chapter of SFM. So I hope all of you are ready. So first question to you is, what is the basic difference between short-term decision making and long-term decision making? Basic difference, sir, short-term decision making does not involve net present value. Precisely, you are 100% correct. Short-term decision making generally involves the questions that do not involve time value of money, and long-term decision making are those questions that generally typically involves time value of money. In our curriculum, we are supposed to deal with short-term decision making and not long-term decision making. It may be possible that one or two questions may be covered by me, wherein I will cover deliberately concept of time value of money, although you will never find time value of money in our curriculum. Okay, sir, you told us in decision making, we are doing business and we are doing certain special kind of business wherein we can say that I have spare capacity, and I am confused that what shall I do with this spare capacity. So rather than wasting the spare capacity, rather than leaving it idle, let's do something, let's utilize it. So we thought about utilizing it, and we started thinking that what shall be the minimum price we shall charge so that we shall not be in worse off situation. Alternatively, we said that we can say that there is a special project wherein we can utilize our this spare capacity. So we are thinking that whether it is beneficial for us in terms of relevant benefit. I am not saying profit and loss. I am not saying that we shall go ahead with accounting principles. I am not going to apply any of the accounting principles in our decisions, because accounting principles are meant for whom? They are meant for stakeholders, and we are management or management consultants. So we are supposed to think from the point of view of management that whether we shall go ahead or not. That's a very simple thing. I gave you an example of that giant wheel, where that person, that giant wheel owner, after a certain period, reduced the price deliberately. He thought that if I will start my giant wheel, my cost will be same. Running the giant wheel will be same. So rather than starting the giant wheel, let's earn few more rupees. How come he reduced his price in a way that he shall not be in worse off situation? So this was relevant cost analysis. We usually follow three kind of approaches to solve this question. First approach is known as total project cost approach. Second, opportunity cost approach. And third one, incremental revenue and differential cost approach. You are well aware about all three approaches. But question is, when to use which one? Obviously, we will go ahead with incremental revenue and differential cost approach only in a situation when question asks us. So can't we do it on or? Yes, you can do it. You can follow it. But it is always recommended to solve a question using opportunity cost approach and not our incremental revenue and differential cost approach or total project cost approach. Because opportunity cost approach considers all the avenues, and it is considered one of the best approach. It is nothing as such that if you will apply any of the other two approaches, then your marks will get deducted. But the best approach and simplest one is opportunity cost approach. One important thing is, I am supposed to do practice on incremental revenue and differential cost approach after one or two classes, maybe in next class itself. So if I talk about total project cost approach and opportunity cost approach, we learned few basic concepts about relevant and irrelevant costs. I told you that there are certain costs that we consider as relevant, and there are certain costs that are considered irrelevant. Now question is, what are relevant costs, what are irrelevant costs? You said, sir, we are aware that whatever cost is incurring in future, just because we are taking this decision, is known as relevant cost. What is relevant cost? The cost that is being incurred. Why it is being incurred? Just because we are taking this decision. And when it is being incurred? In future, it is not past cost. Hence, it is termed as relevant cost. So, what is non-relevant or other way irrelevant cost? You will say, sir, very simple. A cost that is either not related to decision or it is not in future. I said, how is it possible? You said, sir, for example, I incurred certain amount of money in past. I said past. So what is past? You said past is sunk. We shall think that historical cost, past cost are always sunk cost. We shall never consider those kind of cost, because those kind of cost makes us emotional, and in business there is no room for emotions. Emotions make us weak. While making business decisions, we are supposed to think prudently. For example, I have purchased a phone. I purchased a phone of 5,000 rupees, let us say. Today, that phone, let us say, 1 year has passed and that phone is not working. It's not worthwhile at all. It is, pain in my eye. What you will say? Let's throw it. Okay. I went to Amazon and I saw that there is an exchange offer wherein this 5,000 rupee phone can be exchanged for rupees 1,000. So you will say, sir, on one side we were throwing it and on another side we are getting 1,000 rupees. So obviously you shall go for 1,000. Don't you think we shall think about 5,000 rupees as well, the original cost? You will say, sir, such cost is sunk cost. It is irrelevant while taking the decision because it is pain in your eye. It is of no use. You will not consider this. Whatever cost is already incurred. You shall never think about such cost. This was homely example. If you apply these principles in business sense, whatever the reason may be, whenever we are talking about any cost that incurred in past will be termed as sunk cost. We are never supposed to think about such cost. But sir, what if certain commitment was done in past, but payment was not done in past, rather the payment will be done in future? Now, we shall think very carefully. Is this payment related to decision? No, sir. It is going to be paid in any case, whether you take the decision or do not take the decision. If it is unrelated to decision, obviously, it is committed cost. It is past cost itself, although payment is done in future. Incurrence was already there. You are already aware that incurrence is the most important thing, and the cost has already incurred in past. Only the dispersal is done in future. It can be said that you already dispersed. You think in this way, you already dispersed it, but you have kept the money in your pocket itself. It does not mean that the cost has not been incurred. It is past. It is committed. You will say such cost is irrelevant. We will not think about such cost while taking the decision because it is unrelated to the decision. Obviously, if it is in any case related to decision, for example, you are saying that this cost will be incurred only in a situation when such decision is taken, you will say such cost will be termed as relevant cost. Now, I proceeded further. I said, okay, fine. I agreed that there is one cost that is known as relevant, another one is irrelevant. And we did few questions. There was a question I drafted wherein ITC was thinking about utilizing its idle capacity for production of pencils or pen. But there was one item known as rent. You said, sir, remember, rent here was 4,000 rupees. It was being incurred. Okay. Whenever I will go proceed and produce pens, it will incur. If I don't produce pen, it will not incur. So it is relevant for production of pen. If I produce pencil, it will incur. If I don't produce pencil, it will not incur. So you will say, sir, such rent is relevant in terms of producing pen. It is relevant in terms of producing pencils. So you are going to take such cost as relevant cost in both these things, both these decisions. It is very important cost. It is relevant. Do not think it as irrelevant. It is being incurred for production of pen. If you don't produce pen, it will not incur. Now let us assume, rather than avoidable, it is said that it is unavoidable. Means It will be incurred irrespective of this fact that we produce pen or pencil, or you don't produce anything. Let us say you produce pen, it will incur. You don't produce pen, then also it will incur. Now question is, if it will incur even if you don't produce pen, then don't you think such cost is irrelevant? Yes, sir, it is irrelevant because its commitment was already done in past. So we are right now thinking about a situation where we are saying that what cost are relevant, what cost are irrelevant, if any cost is being incurred just because that particular decision is taken, you will say such cost is known as relevant cost, and even rent will be relevant cost. We are supposed to think about each decision individually. We are not supposed to club two decisions at a time. For example, you will not say that pencils shall be seen simultaneously. No, not at all. You will see only pen. While thinking about pen, you will say that if I produce pen, my cost will of rent will incur. If I don't produce pen, my cost will get saved. So obviously rent is relevant for production of pens. Similar way you will do for pencils as well. So you cannot say that we can take simultaneously. No, each decision is to be taken individually. And this is the basic principle of total project cost approach. Considering these principles and proceeding further, you must be aware that in opportunity cost approach, we did nothing but we treated whatever cost we treated as relevant, whatever revenue we treated as relevant in, let us say, production of pencils, will be taken as opportunity. You will say we will choose one option and we will see what other option we didn't follow. So whatever option we didn't follow will be known as opportunity cost, and we will take only relevant cost, relevant benefit, relevant revenue while calculating this opportunity cost approach, benefits and the net benefit under opportunity cost approach. Now question is, what is differential cost, what is incremental, what is decremental? Incremental means increase, decremental means decrease. When we have more than one option, you can say that we are supposed to follow difference in value. If we follow this option or that option, what is the difference in value? While following such options you will see, sir, that even rent will be irrelevant because it is common in nature. It will be irrelevant because it is common in nature. So you will say, sir, that only in incremental revenue differential cost approach our rent will be irrelevant and it shall not be treated as relevant. Otherwise, in both total project cost approach and opportunity cost approach, you are supposed to do what? You are supposed to treat even rent as relevant. Only in this situation you are not supposed to treat rent as relevant. Yes, I told you, and I told you that there is no need to show sunk cost or committed cost while calculating, while going ahead for incremental revenue and differential cost approach. Then I told you about fixed cost. I told you that only the cost that is being incurred specially is relevant in nature. Means the fixed cost that is avoidable in nature, that is discretionary, that is being incurred just because we are following this option, is known as relevant fixed cost. Otherwise, it will be irrelevant in nature. Then I proceeded further for few examples of opportunity cost. I told you in first case, there were two cases I took. In first case, I said, that I teach at three different places. First was ITU, second was studio, third was Gurgaon. And I can teach at three places, but at same time slot. I take, let us say, classes only in morning. Now I'm getting confused at which option shall I choose. Obviously, I will choose the option that is reaping highest benefit. You will say, obviously, I shall go for ITU. But what if I see distant benefit and not instant benefit? What is distant benefit and not instant benefit? Obviously, technology is changing, and I think that if I proceed with studio, virtual classroom, my student strength will be more. In future, it is going to help me a lot. For example, you must be aware that I started pen drive classes very, very early. I started application mobile tablet classes very early. Nobody across the means nobody in our field started providing classes on tablet or mobiles. I started the same. So you will say, sir, it is obvious that it may be possible that you may seek future benefits, not instant benefits. So you might be inclined to go ahead for studio. If you go ahead for studio, sir, what will happen? How to calculate opportunity cost in such scenario? The simple solution is, what you will do, you are first of all supposed to cross the option that you are thinking about following. Think as if this option is not available. Now my question is, if this option is not available, which option you will choose? You will obviously say, sir, we will go for IT. So you will not say we will go for Gurgaon, but next is 105. No, not at all. We are aware. Next best means, if we don't have this option, then what will be the next best option? So obviously in this situation, benefit foregone is of ITU. When we will forego the benefit, you will say, when we will proceed and go ahead with studio option, we won't be able to teach at ITO. We were not going for Gurgaon. If we were not thinking about studio, we were not going for Gurgaon. So obviously you will say, if we went for studio, we foregone the benefit we were having in ITO option. So you will say, sir, our opportunity cost will be 1,50,000 and it will not be 1,05,000. You will say 125 minus 150, 25,000 negative is the net benefit. You will say negative net benefit. So you will say, sir, shall we proceed for a studio? Yes, because of certain non-financial factors. Non-financial factors are very important. We are not taking decisions only on the basis of financial factors. Rather, we are taking decisions on the basis of non-financial factors as well. The second situation was, in the first situation which we said that we can produce either, let us say, there were three items, but we can produce one of them. So what is the opportunity cost if we choose one of them? So obviously you calculate in such similar scenario. Here I am saying that let us say we are producing all three products and there is fourth product that we can produce, but we need to forego one particular product, then which option you will forego? And whatever option you will forego will be known as opportunity cost. Here I took an example of myself where I told you that I have, let us say, three options, ITO, studio and Gurgaon. If I proceed for, let us say, if I produce for proceed for, let us say, you will say Connaught Place option. I was teaching at three places at three time slots. Because of human being, I cannot teach more than this. So I was teaching at three places in three time slots. I am thinking about following even Connaught Place option. So you will say, if you proceed for Connaught Place, you need to forego either of the three. So which one you will forego? You will say, I will forego that one which was yielding least benefit. So I will say, okay, fine. Let's forego Gurgaon. That's the difference between two. There we said that whatever option we were following, we were first crossing that option and we were thinking that if this option was not available, which option would have been chosen? That option was foregone. Here we are saying that just because we have another option, which option we shall forego? We shall forego that option that is yielding least benefit. That's the difference. To understand properly, you need to have proper understand properly, you need to think properly. What is the difference between two cases? There we can produce only one product at a time. Here we were already utilizing resources and production of three products. So obviously we will forego which product that is yielding least contribution or least benefit. That's my point. I told you about cost components. I told you that there are three kind of cost: material, labor, other expense. If I there are two kind of costs. One is direct, one is indirect. Means direct cost means a cost that is incurred directly on a particular product. For example, in plastic bottles, plastic is the direct material. And indirect is like supervisor cost in a factory. You will say, let us say one supervisor is utilized for production of plastic as well as glass bottles. So you cannot distinguish about the salary to be allocated. You are not able to easily allocate the salary of such supervisor between these plastic bottles and glass bottles. So you are thinking not directly, you are thinking indirectly how to differentiate between two. So that's what we call indirect cost. Indirect costs are also known as overheads. Direct costs are known as prime cost. Then we proceeded for material and labor. Before material, I shall proceed for depreciation and other expenditures such as notional cost. Remember, depreciation is an accounting treatment. It shall not be taken into consideration, not at all. We are supposed to take only cost of asset. If such machine is purchased in future, it will be relevant. If it is purchased in past, it is irrelevant. Secondly, any notional expenditure, let us say notional office expenditure, notional branch rent, or any interest notional that you charge deliberately in your P&L account shall not be taken into consideration, because that is meant for stakeholders purpose only and not for management. Now we are proceeding for material cost. Material can be of two types. First is it can be in stock, obviously, and second is it is not in stock. If obviously you do not have material in stock, you will say you are going to purchase such material. So whatever incurrence will be there, that is current purchase price, will be your relevant cost, whatever increase is there. Now if material is already in stock, then there can further be two situations. One, material is rarely used. It was lying as it is from several days and it was of no use. We were thinking of disposing such material. And second situation can be that material was in regular use of other production. It was in regular use for in other production. So you will say, obviously we need to first of all classify that whether material is in regular use or it is in irregular use. If material is, let us say, regular use or irregular use, make sure whatever, whether it is of regular use or it is of irregular use, the original cost, original book value, the original cost of material will always be sunk in nature. You are never supposed to consider such cost while taking a decision, because it was incurred in past. We are not supposed to think about such costs. Now let me further proceed. Let us take one by one. If material is already lying with you and it is of no use, you were thinking, you were planning to dispose it off, but all of a sudden there is an offer where such material can be used. You will say, sir, whatever the opportunity I was getting, whatever the benefit I was reaping on selling, on disposing of that particular material, will now be treated as opportunity cost in this new project. Why it shall be treated as opportunity cost in this new project? You will say, sir, obviously the whatever the benefit I was getting in that earlier disposal, obviously only in a situation when this new project will reap more than this benefit, I will proceed for this decision. Otherwise, I will prefer to sell it or dispose it. I will prefer to dispose it rather than utilizing it in special project. When you will say, sir, it is not reaping the equivalent or more benefit in new or special project. Okay, second situation, you will say, sir, let us say there were two options. One was to dispose it, Let us say 5000 was the realizable value. 5000 was the realizable value. So you will say, sir, if we will dispose this material, we will get 5000 rupees. Another way was to utilize such material as a substitute, as a substitute for another material that was in regular use. Let us say this material is material A, another material is material C. Our research team just found that this material A can be used as a substitute for material C. Provided, to use it as a substitute, we need to incur 10,000 as transformation cost. I said, okay, I will transform it, I will incur 10,000 transformation cost. But tell me, what will be the cost that will get saved if we don't purchase that material C and utilize this material A in place of material C? You said, let us say it is 16,000. 16,000 was the cost of material C that was being incurred to purchase in and utilize such material in regular production. But because we are planning to utilize material A in place of material C, you are saying, sir, it is very simple to understand that because material A is being utilized, you are saving 16,000, but you are incurring 10,000. So your net savings is of 6,000. So you said, sir, we are getting a net savings of 6,000 means this is also benefit. 1 rupee earned is 1 rupee saved is equal to 1 rupee earned. We all know this. 1 rupee saved is equal to 1 rupee earned. So you will say, sir, this is 6,000. There we were having 5,000. So obviously we will go for that particular option where we have more benefit. So you thought about going for substitute. Then all of a sudden you came to know that there is a special project where this material can be used. There is a special project where this material can be used. Now you started thinking again. You said, okay, let us utilize this material in that particular special project. If I will utilize this material in that particular special project, you will say, sir, what will happen? I said, my 6,000 benefit will get forgone. Who is going to pay this 6,000 rupees to me? You said, okay, let's do one thing. Let's check that whether this new project is going to reap 6,000 as benefit or not. Only if we will reap more than 6,000 rupees, we shall proceed for this particular project. Otherwise, we shall use it as substitute itself. So you will say the minimum price we shall charge on this special project for this material shall be rupees 6,000. Got it? Now, one last thing was in this material that was lying as it is, real used material. It was that material that is lying is of toxic nature, or you are planning to get rid of it, but there is disposal cost to get rid of it. And all of a sudden you get an offer from, let us say, another place, another project, etc., where this material can be used. So if you utilize this material in a special project, you will say, I saved money. I saved my disposal cost. Let us say 400 rupees was the disposal cost. You will say that I saved my disposal cost of rupees 400. Otherwise, I would have incurred rupees 400 to dispose of this material. Now I don't need to incur these 400 rupees. So this 400 is either will be termed as cost saving, or it will be said that these 400 rupees are negative opportunity cost. So you will say, okay, sir, better, what is a better way of saying? Obviously, negative cost is equal to revenue or benefit. So you will say, sir, savings is equal to negative cost. It's better to say negative cost rather than saving, because everywhere we are taking opportunity cost as positive. In this special condition, we are supposed to show that rather than positive, it is negative opportunity cost. So this is the better way of expressing the same thing. Then a situation when we already have the material, but such material is in regular use. Let us say we already have a material and it is in regular use, and all of a sudden there is a special project where similar kind of material is utilized. What you will do? you will do what? Because business is yours, you will take this material to this special project and you will order new material for the special project. Because demand of special project is already fulfilled, because you already supplied material from your internal sources, you will say, what we will do, we will say the supplier that rather than providing it for at workstation of special project, provide such material at workstation of regular business only, because we have taken this material from there. So you will say, sir, extra increase just because we followed this special project was the purchase price, the market value, or you can say the current replacement cost, replacement price. Why? You will say replacement cost because we replaced this material. We took it from there and we will replace from supplier. So you can say current purchase price or replacement cost. Either way you can say, you will say this is your relevant cost. So this was relevant cost in terms of material. Now let us proceed for relevant cost in terms of labor. Labor can be of two types. One is casual and one is permanent. Obviously, if nothing is said, we will think that we already have regular labor in our company, in our organization, in our workstation or production team. Let us say there is a special project, what you will do? You will definitely go to your regular labor because you have already commitments with them. You are aware that irrespective of this fact that we have this special business or not, we are going to pay such labor. We are going to pay such labor. If such labor has idle capacity, obviously labor will say, okay, I will do this work for you. And or you will say to, you will command this labor that you are sitting idle, rather than sitting idle, do this special work. For example, there is a peon who is sitting idle. All of a sudden, I am a neighbor. I also have an office next to your door. And I said that, can you please help me? Can you please send your peon to this place? Or can you send the peon in basement to and ask him to bring, let us say, goggles for me? You will say, okay, sir, there is nothing as such. You will order it. Now, does peon charge me extra? Answer is no. Does peon charge you extra? Your answer is no. So obviously, similar situation is here. Your company is, your organization is already having certain labor that is permanent nature and that cannot be retrenched. You are supposed to pay them, maybe on hourly basis, but you are supposed to pay them. Now, if such labor was sitting idle and we got a special project, such labor is utilized on this special project and only idle time is utilized, you will say that our relevant cost will be nil. Why our relevant cost will be nil? Because no additional cost is incurred. On the contrary, if you will say that labor was already busy in doing certain amount of work, we will ask him or her to do overtime and complete this special project. If he or she do overtime, what we are going to pay? We will pay him or her overtime wages. Overtime wages consist of two things. One is normal wages, second is overtime premium. Premium means extra, over and above the normal wages, basic wages. So you will say, okay, this will be our relevant cost. And if they don't have this willingness to work in overtime, what we will do? We will go in market, we will fetch certain amount of casual labor, we will hire a contractor, we will say, okay, I need your labor, or we will go to labor chalk, we will arrange some labor from there and we will pay them. We will pay them on daily basis, hourly basis, whatever it is, we will pay them. So whatever wages we are incurring are relevant in nature. Second situation is we went to contractor and he said that all labor is means there is no labor available right now, and all labor is already engaged or they have went back to their villages, etc. So we will say, okay, fine, let's do one thing, let's shift the labor from our current production to this work. Let's shift our labor from current production to this work, this special project, but we need to make sure that our benefits shall not get hampered. So what we need to charge, we will charge relevant cost as wages plus opportunity cost. And I told you that few people say that because wages are committed in nature, that wages are committed in nature, hence wages shall be taken as nil, both means at both the places. When I said wages plus opportunity cost, so while I said wages, it shall be taken as nil, and while calculating opportunity cost also, we shall treat wages as nil only. That's my point. Last point, last two, three points. What is relevant cost of fixed overhead and variable overhead? I told you, variable overhead are relevant. They are always relevant. Whatever overhead absorption rate, etc., has been given shall be treated as relevant cost. They are always relevant. If I talk about fixed overhead, you will say absorption rate is irrelevant and only the additional increase is relevant. We need to be very cautious in terms of absorption rate. Somewhere we will say, we will be told that this fixed overhead is added, somewhere it will be told as fixed overhead is recovered, applied, absorbed. These all are accounting treatments and we are not supposed to go into nitty-gritties of accounting treatments. There are several Ind AS, IFRS that you are learning or will learn. So I shall not go into those things. Last was machine. I told you that machine can be of two types. One, machine is of regular use and you were planning to purchase such machine in future. You thought that the increase in terms of machine will be, let us say, 5, just a second, let me draft an example. Let us say increase, you were planning to purchase a machine after 6 months for regular production of, means there were several other products that you were producing and you require machine for such products. The increase that you are planning to do is rupees 5 lakh. Now, if you utilize such machine at this place, it means you purchase such machine early just because you need to do special project. You will say, let us say it cost rupees 6 lakh today. You will say rather than 5 lakh, we incurred 6 lakh, means 1 lakh extra just because of this special project. It may be possible that rather than 6 lakh, it could be 4,50,000, then it will be beneficial situation. Means 50,000 will be your cost savings. Just because you do this special project, you will say we have a cost savings. But typically we see that question will be that at the end of this special project, if we purchase this machine, it will cost you rupees 5 lakh. If we purchase it today, it will cost you 6 lakh. So what is the additional increase? It is 1 lakh. That additional increase is your relevant cost. And last but not the least, you will say, sir, you will say your machine is not of regular use. You will say your machine is not of regular use and it is lying as it is. You are planning to dispose it off. all of a sudden, you were planning to dispose it off, all of a sudden you receive an offer where this machine can be utilized. Now, when you were disposing it, let us say it was yielding rupees 2 lakh. But if you will utilize this machine in this special project, after this special project, this machine can be sold, let us say, for only 1.5 lakh. So you will say 50,000 lost just because we utilize this machine in this special project. Hence, our relevant cost is 50,000.
Subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell icon for never missing latest videos.